and gentlemen, welcome to once again another virtual release of the Financial Stability Review, which is our second edition for the year 2020. We do publish the Financial Stability Review twice a year, and through this publication, the South African Reserve Bank communicates its assessment of financial stability risks and mitigation actions to the public. Your presence in this virtual Financial Stability Forum is much appreciated. The intention of the forum is to engage the public and enhance the public understanding of and encourage informed debate on matters relating to financial stability. Since the publication of the previous Financial Stability Review in May, incoming data have confirmed the unprecedented severity of the global economic downturn in the second quarter of this year. South Africa has been among the countries experiencing particularly severe output contraction. The global economy is now starting to show signs of stabilization and recovery, albeit in the face of significant headwinds. Moreover, conditions in financial markets have improved in recent months, and the immediate risk of global financial crisis has been contained. Given the unprecedented shock that COVID-19 and the associated containment measures caused, these outcomes have only been possible because of extensive policy interventions from central banks and governments across the world. We have also recently received positive news regarding various successful trials for COVID-19 vaccines. While this would imply some upside risk to the SARB's economic forecast, I would caution that the rollout of these vaccines could take a significant amount of time. The SARB's current projections suggest that the South African economy will take at least 3 years to simply recover to 2019 levels of economic output. Job losses and business closures cannot easily be reversed. The South African Reserve Bank was well aware of the potential for adverse outcomes like these to cascade through the economy as COVID-19 hit our shores. Thus, many of the recent policy measures that we have implemented were designed to address these so-called negative feedback loops. By making adjustments to both interest rate and financial sector regulations, we have helped to support credit extension and avoid unnecessary foreclosures, otherwise financially sound businesses and households. These households have been severely, and businesses have been severely impacted by the pandemic. These policy interventions were made possible by the SARB's unwavering commitment to price stability and financial stability during the period prior to COVID-19 hitting our shores. This included various reforms to financial sector regulation, as well as our focus on anchoring inflation expectations. These moves created the necessary policy space to provide accommodation to the South African financial system without compromising financial stability. The Financial Stability Review provides a detailed overview of the policy measures that the SARB has implemented and their effect thus far. A key component of the latest Financial Stability Review is the presentation of the solvency stress test undertaken on South Africa's six largest banks, which were designated as systemically important financial institutions during 2019. This stress test allows the SARB to determine whether the banking sector will remain adequately capitalized over the medium term under various scenarios. I'm happy to report that even under a worse economic downturn than the SARB currently projects, these banks are expected to maintain an aggregate level of capital above the current minimum regulatory requirement. This is a testament to the strength of South Africa's banks and to the regulatory reforms I referred to earlier, which have, among other things, significantly enhanced both the quality and quantity of bank capital. While the South African Reserve Bank does not expect financial stability to, while we expect the financial stability to remain intact, I would like to emphasize the need to avoid complacency. Indeed, things could go worse before they get better for many financial sector firms. A key risk facing the financial system at this stage is the potential for the debt service capacity of borrowers to deteriorate further as the relief measures provided by both and the financial sector come to an end. Linked to this is the potential for a second wave of COVID-19 infections in South Africa, which could constrain the nascent economic recovery. The financial stability review presents a detailed analysis of these and other risks currently facing the financial sector. I will now hand over to Alex Smith, who will take us through a more detailed presentation on the key messages contained in the financial stability review. At the end of the presentation, there will be an opportunity for questions, and members of the Financial Stability Committee are here with us to answer the questions. Alex, over to you.
Thank you very much, Governor, and good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Let me prepare my presentation. Before I start presenting, I'd like to just reiterate that the Financial Stability Review has a lot of very interesting information in it. I'm not going to be able to present on all of it today, given time constraints, but I would strongly encourage you to go and have a look at the document and read through it, because there's a lot of valuable information in there. Right, so onto the presentation for today. I will begin just by showing a layout. So basically the presentation will be divided into four parts. I'll start by talking about current financial stability risks, and then we'll move on to the financial sector resilience to these risks, and there will be a specific focus on the banking sector stress test results that the Governor alluded to. In the financial stability review, the stress test results have their own thematic chapter, because they are incredibly important, and they form the basis for how the SARB thinks about forward-looking resilience in the financial system. Then the third part of the presentation, I'll talk about the policy actions that the SARB has undertaken to enhance financial stability. Obviously, given the challenging environment, there have been a number of policy interventions undertaken since March of this year. And then finally, I'll conclude, and there'll be an opportunity for questions. Okay, so let's talk first about financial stability risks. Let me show you the risk assessment matrix. So this is a matrix that the SARB produces through the Financial Stability Committee, and it provides a forward-looking view on the key risks to financial stability in the view of the SARB's Financial Stability Committee over a medium-term horizon. I think a couple of points I'd like to make about the risk assessment matrix are that it contains an unusually number of high likelihood risks and an unusually large number of risks that are increasing. And this really reflects the challenging outlook that the economy and the financial sector currently face. So to briefly go through the risks, of course, front and center is COVID-19, still posing a significant threat to the broader economy and the financial system. As the Governor mentioned, the risk of a second wave of infections remains, notwithstanding positive news regarding vaccines that we've had in recent days. But it's not just the impact on the macroeconomy that that concerns us. Coronavirus also poses risks to financial firms such as insurance companies that are insuring against morbidity and in terms of the health of individuals, and also insuring against business interruption claims, which have been quite substantial in recent months. The other high likelihood risks that we have on the risk matrix include a further deterioration in domestic macroeconomic conditions. Of course, this is linked to COVID-19, but there's also a discrete aspect to this, which is that when the economy faces a big macroeconomic shock like the one we've just had, there is a risk of what economists call hysteresis, which is basically that the economy fails to recover and that job losses and business closures become permanent features in the economy. And this is certainly a risk that that we're taking quite seriously at the moment. And it was something that was top of mind when policy interventions were undertaken to address COVID-19. The third significant risk on the matrix is the financial sector sovereign nexus. And this really refers to the interlinkages between government and the financial sector in an environment of high and rising public debt, as well as increasing exposure of the domestic financial sector to this government debt. And I'll talk a little bit more to that in a moment. The other risks, which are slightly lower down on the matrix, include the potential for a rapid tightening in financial conditions. This is a risk we've seen as reducing since the previous FSR in May of this year. And that is because of significant policy interventions that have taken place globally, which have helped to loosen financial conditions and to make it easier for borrowers to access finance, both domestically and internationally. Other risks also include a potential cyber attack. That's something that we have been cognizant of for a long time. But in recent months, with many financial sector staff working from home and many other operational disruptions having taken place, there are certainly new cyber attack paths that have been created. And then finally, climate change is a significant financial stability risk. Of course, most of us think of it as an environmental issue, and it certainly is. But it also poses risks to the financial system, both the physical risks, which reflect the potential for assets to be damaged by adverse weather conditions linked to climate change, as well as transition risk, which reflects changes in policy and preferences, which can adversely impact both income streams and asset values. Imagine that consumers prefer not to buy a certain type of product anymore because they believe it to be environmentally damaging. If a lot of money has been invested in producing that product, that money can potentially be lost. If you read the Financial Stability Review, you'll be able to get a lot more information about all of these risks. But let me just take you briefly through a couple of the key points. So beginning with COVID-19 and its impact on the economy, I think it's quite difficult to actually wrap your head around how severe the impact on the economy was in the second quarter of this year without looking at this graph on the left-hand side. It indicates that GDP growth fell by 17% year on year, and the graph goes all the way back to 1961. And as you can see, in the past half century, South Africa has not experienced an economic shock of this nature, nothing even close. So it really was a very, very severe shock. As the governor mentioned, the economy is starting to show signs of recovery following an easing of lockdown measures. However, the chart on the right-hand side shows the SARB's latest forecast for the level of GDP, the level of economic activity. That's the pink line, as well as the green line, which is the SARB's forecast prior to COVID hitting the economy. And you can see that that pink line, even in 2022, remains below where the economy was in 2019. So even by 2022, the economy is still going to be producing less output than it was in 2019, based on our latest forecast. And our forecast suggests that total output will be about 7% lower than what we thought prior to COVID-19 emerging. So this isn't just a short-term shock to the economy. This is potentially quite a long-term shock, which will have ramifications for years to come. And of course, this spills over onto the financial system in terms of non-performing loans, that is the people's ability to repay their loan, households and firms' ability to repay loans, as well as profitability and new credit growth. Another point worth bearing in mind is that the economy entered the current recession with relatively high levels of debt. This chart shows the debt of households, corporations, and government. Bear in mind that it is measured as a share of GDP, which is the typical way to measure debt. But in this case, because of the sharp drop in GDP in the second quarter, debt as a share of GDP jumped. So this does highlight the risks associated with this drop in GDP. But I think it's also worth taking a look at the evolution of debt prior to 2020. Certainly, government debt has been increasing steadily for a number of years. Meanwhile, private sector debt has been relatively stable as a share of GDP in the years prior to 2020, but it has been at a fairly high level, stable at a high level. And indeed, corporate sector debt currently is above where it was prior to the global financial crisis, which was a period sort of thought about as one in which there was quite a lot of borrowing from corporates. So it is worth bearing in mind that that the economy enters this recession with fairly high levels of debt, and that does imply a degree of vulnerability on the part of borrowers under the current circumstances. However, the good news is that global financial conditions have eased, and the price of financial assets has rebounded in many cases. So what do I mean by financial conditions? Well, we think of financial conditions simply as a sort of composite measure, which is a proxy for how easy it is and how costly it is to borrow in financial markets. So the chart on the left-hand side shows that spike earlier this year, where it became much more difficult and more expensive to access finance for various borrowers. But following substantial policy interventions from governments and central banks globally, these conditions have eased to much more normal levels. The right-hand chart simply shows the index value of the JSE All Share, the South African stock market, as well as the S&P 500, the US stock market. And what we can see is that following a big dip in March of this year, these stock exchanges have recovered, or the value of the stocks has recovered quite substantially. And in the case of the S&P 500, is actually above where it was prior to the start of the year, which is very encouraging and clearly indicative of some return of confidence in financial markets. But it's not all good news in financial markets. Because domestically, longer duration government bond yields remain elevated. And part of that is because foreign flows of capital have been exiting the economy in recent months. So this chart on the left-hand side shows government borrowing costs. The green line shows shorter-term borrowing costs, and the orange line shows longer-term borrowing costs. And the blue line is simply the difference between the two, what some analysts call the slope of the yield curve, difference between the cost of borrowing long versus borrowing short. Now, as you can see, the blue line there, the dark blue line, the slope of the yield curve, is at its highest level on a monthly basis since we've been collecting the data in 1960, suggesting that there's quite a lot of fiscal risk priced into government borrowing costs at this stage, investors are demanding a substantial premium to lend to government on a long-term basis. And at least part of that is because of these outflows of funds from the bond market that have occurred in recent months. And there have also been outflows from the equity market. So cumulatively, up to September of this year, approximately 200 billion rands worth of funds, worth of foreign funds, had flowed out of the domestic economy. And that really does underscore the degree of risk aversion that had been present in the markets, particularly in March, April, and May of this year. But it is concerning that foreign capital has continued to flow out in more recent months. And of course, as I mentioned, some fiscal risk is behind these moves, although there are other factors at play as well. So earlier I alluded to the financial sector sovereign nexus as a risk. So I think this just provides a little bit more color to that. This left-hand chart shows government debt levels projected out until 2023. These are National Treasury's own projections. And I think the key point to highlight here is how much these projections have changed through time. So as recently as the national budget in February of 2019, National Treasury projected that government debt would peak at around 60% of GDP. Last month, in the medium-term budget policy statement, the projection was revised up, and debt is now expected to reach 90% of GDP by 2023 and is projected to stabilize around 95% of GDP, a very substantial upward revision. And as a result of the fact that foreigners have been selling government bonds on net, the domestic financial sector has been picking up the slack and taking up more of government's debt issuance. And so this right-hand chart here just indicates the increasing exposure of the domestic financial sector to government debt. Now, this poses a risk to the financial sector because as government's credit ratings are downgraded and as concerns around the debt service costs of government increase, this can spill over onto the institutions that are lending money to government and spill over onto concerns about their own solvency as well. And hence, what we've seen recently is that banks tend to have a credit rating which is linked to that of the sovereign. So as the sovereign is downgraded, so bank credit ratings tend to be downgraded as well. Now, there's also some solvency risk that's starting to grow in the private sector. These two charts show non-performing loans for both households and corporates. Non-performing loans in this case refers to loans that are 90 days or more overdue. So I think what we can see here, a couple of key takeaways are that households are clearly facing greater strain right now than corporates are, because non-performing loans in the household sector are around 11% of total loans. We can see that green line refers to unsecured credit on the left-hand chart. So unsecured non-performing loans are a little bit higher than secured loans. Both are relatively elevated and are rising. On the right-hand chart, we can also see a similar trend for corporate non-performing loans. They are increasing. However, the level is much lower. So total corporate sector non-performing loans are still slightly below 2% of the total loan book. And what we can also see there is that your smaller enterprises are facing greater solvency pressure than larger enterprises at this stage. But I think it is worth noting that over the coming months, further upward pressure on non-performing loans is likely. And this is at least in part due to the fact that many loans have been restructured and allowing these borrowers a temporary reprieve, particularly those borrowers that were affected by COVID-19. But ultimately, these restructured loans will have to be repaid. And I'll talk a little bit more about these loan restructures in a few minutes. Right, so those are some of the key risks facing the financial sector. But of course, it's important to think about the extent to which the financial sector is likely to be resilient to these risks. And in particular, I'll refer to the stress test results. So as I've mentioned, we undertook this top-down banking sector solvency stress test a few months ago in response to COVID-19. We believed that it was very important to determine whether the banking sector would have enough capital to withstand a COVID-19 shock, and indeed something potentially even more severe. So as part of the stress test, three scenarios were considered. The first is a pre-COVID-19 baseline scenario. It's always important to have a baseline against which to compare other impacts. So that scenario was based on the SARB's economic forecast in January 2020, prior to COVID-19 becoming a big issue for the economy. Then the second scenario is a COVID-19 baseline scenario. So that's based on the SARB's May 2020 forecast, which included a significant impact from COVID-19. And then the third scenario is a stress scenario, which is an extension of that May 2020 forecast, but with a more severe domestic and international economic downturn. You could think of this as a sort of second wave of infections domestically and internationally, or an even worse hit to the economy than the SARB had previously expected. The solvency stress test covers the six largest domestic banks, those that the governor designated as systemically important financial institutions, and they account for more than 90% of total banking sector assets, so pretty much a representative coverage of the sector. We call it a top-down stress test because it uses internal SARB models that apply economic scenarios to the bank's data in a consistent way across all banks. The other approach that you can use is a bottom-up approach, but we thought that consistency was important in this case. Applying the top-down approach was the most sensible way to do the stress test, in our view. And it's important in particular to comprehensively model the impact of these scenarios on bank capital. And this was done both through the supply side as well as the demand side. So when you think about capital supply, that really speaks to the ability of banks to build capital, and that typically occurs through profitability. So when we looked at capital supply, we modeled the impact of these scenarios on both interest and non-interest income in the banking sector, as well as the banking sector's operating expenses and credit losses. Credit losses being a very important part of these scenarios, given the severity of the economic impact. Then we also looked at capital demand, which refers to the need for banks to hold additional amounts of capital linked to risks that they face. So we considered a full range of risks, including credit risk, market risk, counterparty credit risk, and so forth. I'd also just like to highlight some of the assumptions that were built into the stress test, because these really are key to the results and key to understanding the results. So we were very conservative in the assumptions that we took. So we assumed no additional capital issuance by banks. We assumed no provision for COVID-19 related loan restructures, which did take place, but they weren't factored into the stress test. We assumed the banks would pay no dividends in 2020, which is in line with the guidance that the Prudential Authority had provided, but that dividend payments would continue from 2021. We assume no curing of exposures that have defaulted, and no management actions on behalf of banks. And very importantly, we assumed that the balance of unappropriated profits that were on bank balance sheets at the starting point were excluded from the results of the stress test. So these unappropriated profits account for nearly 1% of total bank capital. But in the interest of conservatism, we excluded them from the results. So you can almost think of these stress test results as being the sort of worst case scenario, particularly when you think about the stress scenario. So let's just look at the macroeconomic impact of these various scenarios. And I think the key message here, the key takeaway is that these scenarios are incredibly severe by historical standards. In fact, you know, outside of a COVID type outcome, it would have seemed almost unrealistic to model such severe economic impacts. So if we look at real GDP growth for these various scenarios, we can see both under the COVID-19 baseline and the stress scenario, GDP growth falling very sharply and only recovering fairly modestly. Our credit growth also projected to slow under the COVID-19 baseline and to turn negative under the stress scenario, much worse than what we saw during the global financial crisis. And then I think the key slide here is the one on the right-hand side, the far right, which shows the depth of the economic contraction under these various scenarios. So the stress scenario shows an economic contraction of 10.5%. If we compare that, for example, to the global financial crisis, the economy only experienced a 1.5% contraction during the global financial crisis. And looking at the scenarios that we modeled for the 2018 stress test, we can see the most severe scenario in our 2018 stress test was a 4.7% growth contraction. So the stress scenario in 2020 is more than twice as severe as that one. So I think it really is important to keep in mind the severity of these stress tests when we think about the results and when we think about the resilience of the financial system. So here are the results. First, have a look at the left-hand chart, which shows the non-performing loan ratio for the banking system under these various scenarios. So we can see both under the COVID baseline as well as under the stress scenario that non-performing loans rise sharply and exceed levels seen during the global financial crisis. But even under these two scenarios, with huge amounts of credit risk and a lot of strain on bank profits, the banking sector retains an average capital adequacy ratio above the minimum requirements. So that's shown on the right-hand side. The current minimum capital requirements on average for these banks is 12.4% of risk-weighted assets. And under the stress scenario, the capital adequacy ratio falls to around 13% of risk-weighted assets. It is worth noting that the capital adequacy ratio bottoms out around the middle of 2022 and then begins to improve gradually thereafter based on the projections in the stress test. A couple of other points I think worth noting. The PA did reduce the minimum capital adequacy ratio of the banking sector by 1% of risk-weighted assets when COVID-19 hit. And although some people have asked whether that was necessary, I think the stress test results clearly show that under a very severe scenario, that probably was warranted. And that has helped to ensure that the banking sector remains adequately capitalized to continue lending into the real economy. Another point that I'd like to make, linking to the assumptions that I spoke to earlier, is that under the stress test scenarios, we see the non-performing loans increasing very rapidly and then peaking around the end of 2020 and then gradually declining thereafter. But because of the loan restructures that have taken place, it's possible that we could see these non-performing loans moving up less rapidly but remaining elevated for a longer period of time. So there could be a sort of a more elongated effect on credit risk than what the stress test demonstrates. But I think the bottom line here is that despite an incredibly severe shock, the banking sector is projected to remain sufficiently capitalized. And this really is a testament to the strength of the sector and to the increased capital that the sector has built up over recent years. In the first edition of the FSR for 2020 that was released in May, we have a thematic chapter covering how the banking sector has become more resilient over the past decade. And I think that's worth having a look at in the context of these results. So, of course, it's not just the banking sector that's important. We also look at other parts of the financial system. And if we move to the insurance sector, we can see also that insurers remain well capitalized. The chart on the left-hand side shows the solvency coverage ratio, which is the key regulatory metric in terms of solvency for insurers. And both life and non-life insurers remain comfortably above their minimum requirements. And indeed, up to June, where this data ends, we haven't seen much of an impact on solvency of insurers of COVID-19. The right-hand chart shows insurance premiums, and those also have remained quite stable. So if you look at the first half of this year relative to the first half of last year, both life and non-life insurance premium income has been pretty much stable, which is quite a good performance given the challenges that the economy has been facing. So also positive results coming out of the insurance sector. We could see some pressure on insurance income in the second half of this year. But as we can see on the charts on the left-hand side, there's quite a big solvency buffer currently in place. Also worth having a look at collective investment schemes. Fairly good news story there in that collective investment schemes have continued to attract inflows of funds, again, despite challenging economic conditions and a lot of market volatility. In the first half of this year, assets under management for collective investment schemes as a whole actually increased slightly and is sitting just below 3 trillion rand. And then the right-hand chart shows a certain type of collective investment scheme called a money market fund. These are funds that invest in short-duration debt instruments. They tend to be quite important in the financial system because these money market funds buy a lot of bank-issued debt. So if you get a big flow of money out of a money market fund, they can be forced to sell this bank-issued debt, and it can be a sort of a run on banks from a wholesale investor perspective. Encouragingly, we didn't see too much of that. There was a little bit of volatility in the holdings of money market funds in the earlier part of this year. But on balance, money market funds actually attracted significant inflows in the first and second quarters of 2020, again, underscoring an improvement in confidence in the financial system. Okay, let's talk briefly about the SARB policy response. Of course, many of the positive outcomes that we see have been supported by the policy response that the SARB undertook. And a number of policy actions were undertaken, some of which were quite original and were focused on addressing the particular shock that was being faced by the economy. In other words, the COVID-19 shock, which is quite an unusual one in that it didn't emerge from within the economy. It wasn't caused by excessive credit provision or excessive risk taking. It was a completely exogenous shock, something coming out of left field, if you like. And that's the fact that it came out of left field did inform the policy response and the types of measures that were undertaken. So first off, the SARB increased provision of liquidity to the banking system. In other words, the SARB provided additional loans to banks to ensure that banks had adequate funds available to them, because during certain times in March and April, where there were flows of funds out of the banking system. In response to some dysfunction in the government bond markets, the SARB purchased government bonds in the secondary markets. And I'd like to mention, of course, that dysfunction in the bond market was not a South Africa-specific event. Even some of the biggest and most liquid bond markets in the world experienced signs of dysfunction during the first and second quarters of this year. Third, the Prudential Authority, the bank regulator, eased bank capital and liquidity requirements. I did allude to those earlier. The PA also adjusted its guidance on the regulatory treatment of loans that are restructured as a result of COVID-19. Now, this was a key measure that had a very significant impact. Typically, what would happen when a bank restructures a loan is that that bank would be required to hold additional capital against the loan, because loans are typically restructured when the borrower faces challenges in servicing the loan. However, a special change to the regulation was made for loans that are restructured as a result of COVID-19. In other words, if the borrower was financially sound but was impacted by COVID-19 or the associated lockdown measures, the bank could restructure that loan, providing the borrower with temporary debt service relief without the need for that bank to hold additional capital. And this this measure facilitated a very substantial restructuring of loans, and I'll show you the numbers in a moment. Another point I think important to bear in mind is that the PA provided guidance that banks should not pay dividends on ordinary shares and should not pay cash bonuses in 2020. Now, one can almost think about this as a quid pro quo for the eased bank capital requirements. Obviously, when the regulator reduces bank capital requirements to provide a little bit more room for banks to absorb credit risk without having to reduce their lending, in that environment, you do not want to see banks paying additional dividends, which can erode their capital. It's preferable for banks to protect their capital in this sort of environment. And hence, the guidance on the non-payment of dividends was made. And this, we believe, had quite a substantial impact, because in 2019, about 12% of bank common equity tier one capital was paid out in the form of dividends and cash bonuses. Also, what has changed recently was an augmentation to the loan guarantee scheme that was launched around the end of March. It was augmented to stimulate take-up in July of this year. As at the end of September, about 16 billion rands worth of loans had been provided through the loan guarantee scheme to businesses. And then finally, a very significant policy adjustment has been the reduction in the repo rate by 300 basis points in 2020, or 3 percentage points. Although this is primarily a monetary policy tool, it has had a significant impact on financial stability by supporting the debt service capacity of borrowers. So let me quickly show you a few figures and some impacts of these policy measures that were undertaken. So this chart on the left-hand side here shows the value of loans that have been restructured by the banking system as a result of COVID-19. The restructures increased and peaked out in July at a level of more than 600 billion rand. That is in excess of 15% of total private sector credit extension. So more than 1.7 million customers, or consumers rather, and more than 30,000 firms benefited from restructured loans. And that has provided them with a bridge to recovery during the particularly harsh or the particularly challenging conditions that were taking place earlier this year during the lockdown. But of course, these loans do still need to be repaid. And this could be a source of credit risk going forward as these loans come due. It remains unclear as to the extent to which borrowers will be able to service the loans. But I think it is also important to bear in mind that these loan restructures and other policy measures taken by the SARB have helped underpin credit extension. So credit extension has remained positive despite the challenging economic outlook. Just quickly on interest rate cuts, as I mentioned, they have supported debt service capacity. So this chart on the left shows household debt as a share of disposable income. And we can see that that jumped rapidly as household disposable income fell in the second quarter of this year. Nevertheless, on the right-hand chart, the green line shows household debt service costs. to disposable income. And although household disposable income fell, the household debt service cost to disposable income ratio actually remained stable. And that's because, as is demonstrated by the pink line, average interest rates on household debt fell sharply thanks to the repo rate cuts. And then the last measure I'd like to point to is the purchasing of government bonds by the SARB, which has significantly improved South African government bond market functioning. So the value of purchases is shown on the left-hand side. We can see that it's been tapering off significantly in recent months. Most of the purchases took place in April and May, and that's when dysfunction was at its, or the risk of dysfunction was at its greatest. So on the right-hand panel, there's two charts there, one showing bid-offer spreads, which is the difference between what someone's willing to pay for a bond and what someone is willing to sell it for. And as those spreads started to widen, there was a risk that buyers and sellers wouldn't be matching in the market and that the market could break down. But since the SARB's intervention began in late March, those spreads have narrowed considerably. The far right-hand panel shows daily trading ranges, which is basically a proxy for volatility in the market. Again, volatility very heightened in March and April, but having come down considerably to much more normal levels in recent months. So let me conclude. South Africa's financial system remains resilient following the initial phase of the COVID-19 shock. And that shock was predominantly about liquidity challenges that were experienced, but have mostly been resolved. However, solvency risks are increasing as restructured loans come due amid continued economic weakness. And this is a key risk that we're keeping our eye on over the coming months. But the domestic banking sector is projected to remain adequately capitalized in the face of these solvency risks and is expected to withstand even a more severe economic scenario than the SARB currently projects. So the bottom line is that financial stability is expected to remain intact despite the near-term challenges. Thank you very much, and we are now at your disposal for questions.
Thank you, Alex. My program here says to me Yolanda is handling the questions. I don't know where she's collecting them from. Is Yolanda there?
Thank you, Governor. I'm here. Governor, I currently have one question for you. It is from Emma Romney from Reuters. And the question is, the SARB said its stress testing showed that South Africa's systemically important financial institutions would, in aggregate, remain resilient under even very high stress scenario. Did any major lenders individually fail the most severe stress test? And if so, which ones?
Is that the only question?
At the moment, Governor, yes, that's the only question.
Emma, fortunately, we found that all of the banks were resilient. There wasn't anyone that was failing. But if there was, we wouldn't have told you anyway, because we do not comment on individual financial institutions. But we are very pleased with the outcome of this stress scenario. You are muted.
Thank you, Governor. I'm still waiting for more questions on the feed. Yes, we have a second question. Again, from Emma Romney from Reuters. And the question says, has the risk of a major bank doing a capital raise changed at all since the last financial stability review? And if so, what is driving that forecast?
Is that it?
We have a second question from Andrea Masia, Morgan Stanley. Can you take the time to talk about the capital account implications of the newly revised inward listing requirements? And that is all for now.
Nigel, can you deal with the capital flows things of the new listing requirements? And then we will come back to the risk of a major bank doing a capital raising.
Thank you, Governor. So, Andrea, I'm sure you saw the press statement this morning that the Treasury has issued, effectively withdrawing the Circular 15 of 2020 because there was significant confusion in the market. Let me clarify what was the intention of the reform. In the medium-term budget policy statement, the Minister announced the intent to deal with two issues. The first is to allow companies that are listed on the Johannesburg Stock Exchange to allow neutrality between debt and equity instruments. That was the first change. The second was that South African companies, resident companies that issue rands or dollar instruments on the exchange, for that to both be treated as domestic instruments. It is an attempt to liberalize exchange controls. It is an attempt to allow South African companies to raise capital in either currency year. And it's also an attempt to allow foreign companies that have a secondary listing on the Johannesburg Stock Exchange to enhance the scope of products and instruments that they have. It was not the intent to allow derivative or exchange-traded products to be used as part of the domestic allowance. It was not the intent of the reform to allow pension funds to increase their holdings of foreign currency assets by changing the prudential regulations through the back door. There was no change to the 30% limit. And because of this confusion, we've decided to withdraw the circular. We will have a period of public comment, and we will hopefully reissue the circular around the time of the budget next year. So in one sense, your question is moot. Because the circular has been withdrawn. But in another sense, it is our policy approach to gradually open up South Africa's market to have more two-way trade, to enable Johannesburg to be a financial center for Africa, to enable companies to raise capital here for investment abroad. And that is the policy intent going forward. What the implications on the capital account, I think you can speculate. In our view, a more healthier two-way flow in the foreign exchange market will be positive for South Africa's financial deepening and integration into the rest of the world in general. Thanks.
Thank you very much. Emma, the assumptions of the scenario specifically state that we are not expecting any bank doing capital issuance. So the no bank was expected to do capital issuance as part of the assumptions. We do not expect any management action in the in any of these scenarios. South African banks, like in previous crises, entered this crisis with adequate capital and with additional capital buffers. When we announced our interventions, we then said that the banks could dip into their capital buffers. They didn't do it because, as it turned out, they didn't have to, because they had adequate capital. So the risk of a bank raising coming, a major bank coming to raising capital, is not even in these scenarios. Does it mean that no bank could want to raise capital? Banks might want to raise capital sometime in the future. All that we are saying is that, given these stressful, extremely stressful scenarios that we have put in place, we had assumed that no bank would have to raise capital. And even with that assumption, the banks have still come out to be having capital above the regulatory capital. So that risk is not there at the moment. Now, do you want to add anything?
No, Chair.
Yolanda?
Governor, thank you. We have two more questions. And the first one is from Brian Khan from 91. And the question is, what do you think are the reasons for the slow uptake of the loan guarantee scheme? And the second question is from Prinesha Naidu from Bloomberg News. And the question is, at what point will the SARB withdraw recommendations? For example, what would give it comfort to be able to withdraw guidance on dividends on ordinary shares and cash bonuses? And we have a third question from Danieli Masia from Deutsche Bank. And the question is, please could you describe the process and circumstances under which you would unwind the bond purchases accumulated up to now? Thank you.
DG Shazivana, you'll deal with the bond purchases. And DG Naidu, can you deal with the withdrawal of the guidance and the reasons for the slow uptake of the loan guarantee scheme, please?
Okay, Governor, if I can go first. So I think that, generally, it's a bit early to be talking about the unwinding of the purchases of government bonds at this point. But when we did make the purchases, we highlighted that this is part of our monetary policy portfolio and that we would be using the government bonds as an active liquidity management measure. That would mean that in the same way that we have been purchasing bonds in the secondary market in the recent past, we might at a later stage, should we need to drain liquidity from the market, be selling the government bonds. So it's something that we generally do not announce to the market when we do it, just to ensure that we don't unduly influence pricing, because that would not be the intent of the SARB. Thank you.
Thanks, Fundi. Brian, on the uptake of the loan guarantee scheme, you know, I think there's a combination of what I would broadly call supply and demand factors. On the supply side, the design of the loan guarantee scheme is quite risk averse, right? It is designed so that you don't get reckless lending, that, and you don't have excessive losses that are either for the bank's balance sheet or for the fiscus. In hindsight, you know, I think there are good reasons for designing it in that way. But the main reason why it was designed in that way is that I think that the banks are quite mindful of the fact that you don't want to design a scheme that implicitly puts a large risk on the fiscus. And that's why the risk-sharing arrangement in the scheme is as such. And therefore, there is a degree of risk aversion in relation to the scheme. Is that a bad thing? In the big scheme of things, I don't think that's a bad thing. I think it is what it is. If we had a different fiscal position, you might have had a different risk tolerance ascribed to the scheme. But it is what it is. On the demand side, demand for credit from the private sector has not been significant. Right? I mean, our assumption at the beginning of the crisis was that everybody is going to have a cash hit. There will be significant demand for credit, and it would be correct for the banks to extend that credit. Now, I guess you could package these companies into three categories. A, those that are extremely good credit risk, and the banks would probably lend or extend credit off their own balance sheet to them. B, customers that are not a good credit risk at all. And it's probably likely that the banks would not want to extend credit to them under the circumstances, and see those that fall in the middle. And the guarantee scheme was designed for those that fall in the middle. Unfortunately, the way in which COVID has impacted on the private sector, there is a little bit of a bifurcation. So that if you are a retailer or a manufacturer or a service-oriented business, your income is probably back up to 80-90% of pre-COVID levels. You might not need the credit. You might need a bit of credit, but not too much. But if you're in the tourism sector, in the hotel sector, in some parts of the restaurant sector, in some parts of the entertainment industry, it is you're quite reticent to take on more credit because you're unsure of the future, you're unsure of when demand will pick up, and you're unsure about whether you'll actually have to pay that, when you'll have to pay, and whether you'll be able to pay that back. So companies are quite risk averse, mainly because they're unsure of the future in terms of economic prospects. I think those are the two main factors that explain the low take-up of the guarantee scheme. The banks have done three things. One is they've provided payment holidays. Two is they've done loan restructurings. And three, they've provided credit in terms of the loan guarantee scheme. In aggregate, the banks have provided about 52 billion rands worth of relief in terms of those three, of which the loan guarantee scheme now is just above 16 billion. The 52 billion rand, or actually the difference between the 52 and the 16, so what's that, 34 billion, is on gross exposures of about 700-800 billion rand, which is quite a sizable share of bank loans. I think the banks have come to the party in the main to support their customers to provide relief. But demand for credit is still relatively weak, and that's one of the key factors. Pranisha, on guidance on dividends and bonuses, when we think that we are out of the COVID crisis, we will lift the guidance. But let me state up front that this is not an easy issue. When we instituted the guidance, I personally was of the view that banks might make losses this year. Banks might genuinely dip into their capital stacks this year. And under those circumstances, capital preservation should be prioritized above all. And therefore, the payments of bonuses and dividends should not be entertained. And we gave what I call strongly worded guidance. Since then, we've seen banks revise down profit estimates by anywhere between 40 and 80%. But in general, the banks still expect to make profits this year, which, again, in March, certainly wasn't my view. But it's quite likely that most banks would still make some profit this year. We want to see a few more data points. We want to see that we're out of the woods on the major credit risks in the banking system. We think IFRS 9 has played a positive role in bringing provisions forward, in banks taking the hit on the chin. But again, there are uncertainties as to how big the credit losses are likely to get. We're comforted that the credit loss ratios are actually declining. And the non-performing loan ratios are declining. But we want to see a few more data points before we would be comfortable withdrawing that guidance. We're not 100% sure that we are out of the woods on credit losses at this stage. We did debate the issue as the Prudential Authority at the end of October. We will debate the issue again at the end of January. And there are two sides of the story. At the moment, we're sticking to that guidance. Because we think that there is uncertainty around future credit losses. Thanks, Chair.
Back to you, Yolanda.
Governor, I've got nothing on the question side. I think that is all for today that we have on the feed.
Well, on that note, then, let me thank everyone for their participation and the panelists for sharing the weight. And a lot of work has gone into this FSR. Special weight of thanks goes to the staff of the South African Reserve Bank and the presenters who made sure that we bring you this high quality publication. Otherwise, do have a Merry Christmas and a very prosperous New Year Goodbye, see you next year.